year, but the year before she was able to come out. So do be sure to say hi to Lori as well. So, all right. Well, we have, as the problem that all of us as preachers have is, other than a small pulpit, but the problem that we all have is there's just a lot of information to go over. And so you just have to go over what you can. And so rather than belabor getting started, let's just get going, all right? Let's just do it that way. I'm going to have you open your Bibles. Actually, my text is out of the book of Ephesians chapter 3. But I'm going to have you open up, go open Ephesians 3, but I'm going to have you open up to 2 Corinthians chapter 2 here. And there's a little phrase that I'm going to read to get started with. And it may not make a lot of sense in connection with the message right now, but I hope that by the end of the message it'll make sense why we brought it up here. The phrase is over in 2 Corinthians chapter number 2, and it's down at verse 3. It's down at verse 3. It's right at the end of the verse. I'll read the whole verse. It says, "And I wrote this same unto you, lest when I came I should have sorrow from them of whom I ought to rejoice, having confidence in you all." Okay, now here's the phrase I want to just kind of, for the moment, everybody just put this in your mind. That my joy is the joy of you all. I want you just to put that phrase in your mind here as we progress with our message tonight. Okay? You can turn to Ephesians chapter 3 here. My topic tonight is in reference to the mystery of Christ. What is its future? What's the future look like for the body of Christ and therefore for me and you? Not just you and me, because, of course, they're members of the body of Christ all over the world. But what's the future going to look like? Look at Ephesians chapter number 3, and if you'll notice, at verse 10 and then down at verse 11, he says, "To the intent that now, under the principalities and powers in heavenly places, might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the what?" What does it say there? Notice it says the eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's unite our hearts in a word of prayer. Our gracious God and Father, we're grateful that we can spend some time this evening in your word. We're grateful that we have your word, that we have reason, therefore, to have confident expectation in what you say and to realize that it is through your word that indeed we have good hope through grace. We pray and ask that as we think especially about our future, the future that you've prepared, the future that you see in crystal clear glory with the Lord Jesus Christ as the center of it all and the new creature, the body of Christ, as your handiwork, your creation, to your glory, to Christ's glory, and all just exalting the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do pray that we might see this in a little bit greater detail tonight. Well, thank you for this in Christ's name. Amen. I want to start this evening with a little bit of an illustration, and the kids that were up here tonight really kind of helped out. Let me ask you, how many of you here tonight had children at some point on the stage? This doesn't count your adult kids, okay? But how many of y'all had children? Go ahead and raise your hand real high. Okay. So what was that like for you to see your child up here on the stage, assuming they were behaving? But let's say they were, okay? But what was it like for you to see your child up here on the stage? What was it like? Was it kind of neat? Kind of exciting? Oh, yeah. And as Richard mentioned, maybe you can use them blackmail years from now when they're, you know, well, you can use pictures of. But you see, think about that. The rest of us here tonight, we got to experience part of your joy. How did that happen? How did it happen? What's that? Watching it. Exactly right. Now, why could we relate to your joy? How come? Because we also have kids. Right? I got to tell you, Lori and I, we became grandparents for the first time. You've heard this story before, right? Okay. No, yeah. We became grandparents for the first time, and only one so far. But we're still pressuring the parents. Anyway, so we became grandparents not quite 2 years ago. And still to this day, I mean, she's the most adorable, precious little girl on the face of the planet, of course, you know. But, you know, they'll send us little video snaps or pictures, and it's strange because when the phone dings, you know, because you know you got an email or a picture or whatever, it stops us both in our tracks. And nothing else matters for that moment where you, oh, look at the video, watch this, oh, let's watch it again and again and again. My wife's got a bunch on the phone. She's right back over there. You can see them. How many of you can relate to that, whether it's your own children or your grandchildren? So in this, or your great-grandchildren, right? So what's happening is that here, the parents are so thrilled with their daughter, and they know how thrilled we are with them and our granddaughter. You can all relate to that because you have children and you have grandchildren and that type of thing. So you understand the concept of sharing in someone else's joy and it bringing you joy to share in their joy. Isn't that something? All right, now keep that picture in mind. If our topic tonight is what's the future going to look like for the body of Christ? In order to really appreciate what the future is going to look like, you know where we got to look? We got to look at the past. We got to look at the past. When I say the past, I don't mean on the chart up here, this past. I mean this past, way out here. Look at these verses, if you would. Let's follow. I know I have my glasses up here somewhere because I just had them. What did I do with them? Here they are. All right. Look at this. Go with me, if you would. Watch a string of verses here, if you would. I want you to get Ephesians 1, and we're going to look at some phrases here. Look at Ephesians 1. You're also going to get John chapter 17. You're also going to get 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. Now, some of these, of course, we've looked at a number of times already this week. There's some phrases that I want you to string together here. Look over to, you should have Ephesians 1. You should have John 17. And then you should also have 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. For those of you that have your Bibles on your cell phone or iPads, that's a little difficult, isn't it? Okay? A guy at our Bible study did this the other day. What he did, he just lined up several devices, a cell phone, an iPad, you know, that kind of a concept. So those of you that have your devices, if you just sit next to someone else that has a device, and you can just kind of share it that way. But at any rate, all right, I just want you to notice some phrases. You'll be familiar with these phrases, so we can do this kind of quickly. But watch this. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. We're looking for some time marks, references to time marks. I'm going to be at verse 4 in Ephesians 1. He says, according as he hath chosen us, when? In him when? Before the foundation of the world. So on the chart, where are we? You're not anywhere on the chart. You're before the chart. Look with me, if you would. You can let go of Ephesians. We'll be back there in a little while. Go to John 17. Go to John 17. What was there before the foundation of the world? Look at John 17. And watch this. Look at John 17, verse 5. He says, and now, O Father, this is the Lord Jesus Christ speaking to his Father, of course. He says, and now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee, when? Before the world was. Where are we on the chart? We're not on the chart. We're before the chart. Okay? All right? We're before heaven and earth. Okay? Look at the same chapter. Look at the same chapter. 17, same chapter. Verse 24. He says, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. And here it is now. For thou lovest me when? Okay, where are you on the chart? You're not on the chart. You're way before. You see that? You're before heaven and earth. Based upon these verses here, what do you know with absolute certainty that existed before the foundation of the world? Obviously, the Godhead. But according to the two verses in John 17, what was the essence of the relationship that existed among the Godhead? What was it? Love and glory. Love and glory. Now, think about that. The Godhead is completely self-sufficient. Lacking nothing, right? So in the Godhead, all that they wore individually and collectively, they shared with one another. They shared in the glory of each other. They shared in the eternal love towards each other. They shared in the very purpose of their existence with each other. Now go with me, if you would, also. You can let go of John there, and you can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. Now watch this. Look over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. Once again, a verse you've seen many times this weekend. Look over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. Watch this. And we're going to look for a similar phrase, different time mark, however, in verse 7. It's not a different time mark. I'm sorry. Look at verse 7. He says, "But we speak the wisdom of God in the mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained." Now, what's the time mark here? What's it say there? When? Where are you on the chart? You're nowhere on the chart. You're before the chart. So look at that. When you put those verses together, when you put all four of those verses together, something was going on before heaven and earth ever came into existence. Right? Something was going on among the Godhead. Eternal glory. Eternal, unending, unfathomable love. And an eternal purpose for their existence. And that verse says, "He ordained before the world unto..." Notice whose glory? Not His glory. Because that glory was... their glory was already there. Understand that? Nothing was going to enhance the glory that was already there among the Godhead. Nothing was going to add to the eternal love that was already there among the Godhead. And yet they came up with a plan and a purpose to express that glory, that love, that fellowship that existed among themselves. They came up with a plan and a purpose to express that with someone else. Why would they do that? If God was completely sufficient in and of Himself, why do you need to do something like this? Why? Love gives. That's exactly right. Love, by nature, gives. Think of all the verses about, "For God so loved that He," what? "He gave. Christ who loved me and gave." The very essence and nature of who God is, He's not only God of love, but because He's a God of love, He's a God of grace. And what does grace do? Love gives, grace gives freely. So now let's take and look at some other references to... the only way I know to say is time marks. Let's go back with me this time to the book of Ephesians once again. Watch this now. Go to Ephesians chapter number 1. Once again, what we're trying to determine is, what's the future of this thing going to look like? But in order to appreciate what's going to look like in the future, when I say this thing, I'm talking about the mystery of Christ, the body of Christ. What's it going to look like there in the future? We get the glimpse of it by looking at the past. Once again, watch these phrases. We already saw the one in Ephesians 1:4. It says, "According as He has chosen us in Him," what's the time frame reference? "Before the foundation of the world," stay in that same chapter. This time you're going to go down to verse 21. "Far above all principality and power, might and in every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in," what's the reference there? "There's a world which is to come." Look at chapter 2, verse 7. Chapter 2, verse 7. "That in the ages to come..." By the way, you notice ages is not singular, but it is what? Therefore, there's got to be at least more than one. You know that for sure. Go back to chapter number 1. Watch this phrase now, chapter number 1. He says at verse 8, "Wherein He hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of His will according to His good pleasure." Keep that word pleasure in mind. His good pleasure. What does He find pleasure in? Who does He find pleasure in? "Which He hath purposed in Himself." Now verse 10. "That in the dispensation of the fullness of time..." Did I read that verse right? I didn't, did I? I left out one little letter. And what was the letter? The letter S. Notice the word there is not time singular, but times plural. There's a dispensation of the fullness of times. That verse is not looking to the past. Now it's looking out to the future. You see that there? Watch this. Go to chapter number 3 of Ephesians. Go to chapter number 3 of Ephesians. We looked at the one in chapter 2, verse 7, the ages to come. Look at chapter 3 this time, and we started over in verse 11. What's the reference there? He says, according to the what purpose? So if it's eternal, when did it start? It didn't. The Bible says about God over in Psalms 90, it says, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. As long as God has been God, the Godhead has loved each other and existed in love one for another. As long as God has been God, the Godhead existed in the expression and sharing of their glory one for another. Also, as long as God has been God, they have reveled in the thought of bringing to pass the revelation of the mystery, specifically the mystery of Christ. It's interesting because you know how we talk about this passage said it was hidden in God. You ever wondered which member of the Godhead? What's the answer, by the way? All of them. All of them. They kept nothing secret from themselves. They kept it secret from everyone else, right? When everyone else eventually was created. But you stay in that same chapter. Look at Ephesians chapter number 3, this time verse 20. Ephesians 3:20 says this, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And by the way, in the context there, the all that you ask or think is not talking about like healing and that type of thing. It's talking about God's intention and plan to bring to pass the mystery of Christ, to bring it to fulfillment. He's going to bring it to pass. And this coming to pass, what his future is going to look like is exceeding abundantly above all that we ever would have asked or thought. And we're trying to get into a little bit of this tonight, right? we're trying to get into something tonight is way beyond what we ever could have asked or thought, and yet his word tells us and gives us details about it. He says this at verse 20, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Here it is. Unto him be glory where? Who's that? That's the believers. That's what Paul calls the mystery of Christ. Christ. The church, the body of Christ. So glory where? Glory in the church by Christ Jesus for how long? What's it say there? Throughout all ages. That's like longer than next week, right? Yeah. A little bit longer. The ages upon the ages. The ages upon the ages. The ages to come. And they are coming. That verse says, unto him be a glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world what? Listen, can I let you in on a secret, but not in the sense how Paul means a secret? The secret is this. This world's going to end. That one that verse is talking about is not going to end. And when that verse says world without end, what did the saints say? Amen. So be it. Bring it to pass. We can't wait. I got a question. All those phrases that we looked at, just and this was just in Ephesians, this section here was just in Ephesians, right? What was the kind of the common thread between all those phrases? What did those phrases just do? Any ideas? How were they all similar? Looking back to when? Before the foundation of the world. Looking where? To the ages to come. Where are you on the chart in those verses? There and there. Can I suggest something interesting tonight? I'm not saying I'm right on this, but it's an interesting thought, I think, anyway. You know how we say and we depict on the chart that the mystery interrupts prophecy? Those verses suggest that's not right. That chart, if I could close that chart, I can't because it'll fall down. Close that chart. Do you realize prophecy interrupted to plan the eternal purpose. You see that? Because the answer to our question, what we're talking about tonight in the message is, what's the future of this thing? In order to look at the future of this, we've got to get off that chart. But not totally. Because we never want to forget that what's going to get us out there started way back there, but could only have been accomplished how? The cross of Jesus Christ, His shed blood, the only way. And only if all humanity was on equal grounds, Jew and Gentile, middle tradition broken down, all guilty, all condemned, and able to be reconciled unto God by the blood of the cross. Placed into one body, this one new creature. See that there? So it's interesting to think about that. To look out there, what's it going to look like out there? We've got to look back there, and we've got to kind of say, hey, wait, let's get off the chart here. I'm not suggesting that chart's wrong. I'm not. By the way, we all understand this chart is not Scripture. The Bible's Scripture. This is simply a depiction of how history works out. So this chart is simply saying that the revelation of the mystery, the revealing of the plan, is what, in fact, interrupted prophecy. That's a true statement. But, boy, when you step back and say, wow, wait a minute. History really interrupted the eternal purpose. Isn't that something? Let's ask a couple of different questions so maybe we can get different answers. I want you to turn now, if you would, over to the book of Revelation. Go to Revelation chapter number 4. Pardon me. Look at Revelation chapter number 4. Revelation chapter number 4. And we're going to look right at the very last verse. Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. There's a statement that we're going to read and then we're going to think about in relationship to our message here. The creatures and the elders, they say this to God. They say, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. You see that phrase there? Now understand this. When that verse says, and when this declaration is made about God, that for Thy pleasure they are and were created. These creatures are not saying, Lord, you woke up, you were bored one day, had to figure out something to do, so you created something to entertain yourself. That's not this. When that verse says, for Thy pleasure they are and were created, that's not the sense of what that verse is saying. God has never been bored in His life. God doesn't need something to entertain Him. God already has something that He's thrilled about. It's a person. His name is the Lord, to you and me, the Lord Jesus Christ, second member of the Godhead. When that verse says, for Thy pleasure they are and were created, it's kind of like the Godhead among themselves said this. And this isn't exactly how it happened. I'm trying to, how can we say this in a way of human where we can relate and so forth? It's almost like the Godhead says this. They said that this love that we have among ourselves, the glory that we share among ourselves, the fellowship that we enjoy among ourselves, the pleasure that we receive from one another and give to one another, the purpose of our existence, living for one another, we cannot keep this to ourselves. It's so good. We've got to share it. And so what they do, God, for His pleasure, He creates all things. The creation winds up being a canvas, like that a painter would use to express his creativity. The creation winds up being the stage upon which a play happens, a very serious and wonderful play, in which the person that's most important to the Godhead, the Lord Jesus Christ, enters onto stage of what is human history and accomplishes the story of redemption and reconciliation. It becomes a theater where God puts on display in the creation a story, His story, about how much the Godhead, they love each other. about the fellowship that they so enjoy, about the glory that they share. Listen, that's what creation's about. Again, he doesn't just wake up one day just kind of bored trying to figure out what to do. It's for his pleasure he did this. But who does he find pleasure in? Do you know what it says? Let's go look at quickly, if you would. Go to Matthew chapter 3 and Luke chapter number 3. Look at this. Look at Matthew chapter number 3 and Luke chapter number 3. Look at Matthew chapter number 3. Watch this. Look at Matthew 3 and verse 17. You know the verse. Look at Matthew 3:17. We'll also look at the parallel passage over in Luke. And again, it will also be over here in Luke chapter number 3. Look at Matthew 3 verse 17. It says this. And lo, a voice from heaven. By the way, let me. I'm going to read back at verse 16. It says this. And Jesus, there's the Son of God. There's God the Son. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God. Well, there's the second. There's God the Holy Spirit. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying. Now here comes God the Father speaking. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Who is it that the Godhead finds pleasure in? The Son. By the way, you notice that this verse says it this way. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This passage, Matthew records it for the benefit of the audience who hears the voice of God, so that the audience can hear God's view of the Son, that he finds pleasure in the Son. Luke records it differently. Look how Luke says it. Look over in Luke chapter number 3 at verse 22. And the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, and a voice came from heaven which said, Thou art my beloved Son. In thee I am well pleased. What was the difference between those two? What was the difference? He said it directly to Christ. You see, he says it so everyone can hear. He says it so the Son can hear. It's like he says, right to the Lord Jesus Christ, Thou art my beloved. In thee, I live for thee. If you go back to John chapter number 17 there, look at John chapter number 17. Watch this. Go back to John 17 here, if you would. Look at John chapter 17 once again. We that was one of the passages we looked at earlier. John 17, watch this. He says, look at all the references to glory here. Verse 1, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son. Well, why? What's it say there? John 17, 1. Father, glorify thy Son. Why? That thy Son also may glorify thee. Who did the Son live for? Who did the Father live for? Look over, if you would, in the same gospel, John 16 at verse 13, it says, Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Watch verse 14. He shall glorify. What's it say there? Who does the Holy Spirit glorify? Who does the Son glorify? Who does the Father glorify? Who does the Son love? Who does the Father love? Who does the Spirit love? Look with me, if you would, over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 1 here. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. Watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. And watch this. 1 Corinthians 1:9. He says, God is faithful, and we're glad for that, right? God is faithful, by whom you were called unto, watch this now, the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I got a question for you. When did you get saved? You personally, just in your life, when did you get saved? Did you get saved like 100 years ago? Some of y'all look like, yeah, no. But, I know it's late and it's a long week and everything, but no. When did you get saved? So was the fellowship that that verse talks about, was that fellowship going on before you ever trusted Christ? Yes or no? Yes, absolutely. You got called into a fellowship that was already happening before you ever even got saved. The fellowship that you and I got called into was the fellowship among the Godhead. The glory among the Godhead, the love among the Godhead, the fellowship among the Godhead, the joy that they shared, their appreciation, their value of each other was existing way before, as long as they've been God. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God in everything that he is. In his love, in his value for the other members of the Godhead, in their purpose, their eternal purpose to create a creature perfectly conformed to guess whose image? Romans 8, the image of his son. His son is the image of the invisible God. So does that make sense why he would want a creature, the one new man, the new creature, to be perfectly conformed to the one that is the treasure of his heart? The one who's the central person of the Godhead in terms of the love and the glory and the fellowship. That's what we've been invited into. That's what we're a part of. We're getting pictures of what this is going to look like out there in the future, right? Is this coming together for you? You know? You see, what happens is the church, the body of Christ, you, me, look at us, look around you. Go ahead, look. Maybe not, but man, things are going to be real different. We are going to have different bodies. I mean, if it would just stop there, that would be good. We're going to have not just resurrected, but glorified bodies, fashioned like unto the glorious body of the Lord Jesus Christ. That body will never fail. It'll never hurt. It'll never be in pain. And according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it's going to shine like the glory of the sun and the stars. It's going to shine in its capacity. By the way, that's one reason. I know some of the brothers talked about this all week already and everything. That's one reason to get sound doctrine in us. You know how light bulbs have different watts, different capacities to shine, right? Get sound doctrine in you now. Because that sound doctrine in you now, right even now, here in this life, has the capacity for the wattage to shine. Okay, I'm not an electrician, but I understand the concept there, right? And how much more out there in glory? In our prayers, we often say, Lord, to your glory. Well, what do we mean by that? Right. You know, by the way, whenever you pray, do you ever stop thinking, what did I just pray and what did I mean by that? You know, right? We probably should stop and think, okay, Lord, I know I just prayed, but and the Lord said, yeah, I waited for you a long time to realize that you just prayed and you didn't have an idea what you were saying, you know. But we say, Lord, may this be to your glory. What does that mean? Taking God's word in us on a regular basis, just little by little, through the struggles of life, the challenges, the ups, downs, the encouraging times, the discouraging times, just learning a walk of faith, not by sight, learning how to allow the Word of God to work in us, learning that it does work in us when we believe, and then that strengthens the inner man. Some of you right now are on journeys that others in this room are not in right now. You know what I'm talking about? Some of you right in this room right now, you're struggling with health issues. You might be in glory soon because of your health issues. I'm not trying to discourage anyone here, really. But I'm saying when you go through difficulties and challenges of your life, it tends to make the doctrine real or not. Doesn't it do that? It's like a laser focus on, okay, that's what that verse says. I've been teaching those verses for all these years. At some point, I probably ought to believe it, and now's a pretty good time. And then you decide, I'm going to trust what it says. Lord, I've got nothing else I can do but just trust what it says. Those of you that know what I'm talking about, what did you find? It worked. It produced in you a far more exceeding and eternal way to glory. Tribulation really does work patience, but you'll never know unless you have the opportunity to go through a time like that, which is the opportunity to learn to trust it. Other than that, it's just all theory. It's all intellectualism. One of the great dangers that I as a preacher have and that other preachers have is being so filled with intellectual verses and being able to quote verses and turn to verses and everything. But listen, do I trust them myself? That's a great struggle, right, preachers? Anybody disagree with me on that? It's a great struggle that we go through, Lord. I say I believe that verse. Now I need to trust it. You got to quit playing the game. Quit putting on the charade. And it's difficulties and challenges of life that say, okay, here's your lion's den. Here's your fiery furnace. Here's your opportunity to say, okay, Lord, I'm going to rest in your word. And that doctrine working in us right here, right now, it really does produce and impact eternal glory. It really does. You may not see it right now other than just a little glimpse of it. It will be seen out there in the future. See that? Look with me, if you would, go back to Ephesians chapter number 1. Go to Ephesians chapter number 1. Let's get a few more details on this. These verses that we're going to look at now, again, we've seen these verses. We've talked about these verses all week. How could you not, if you're at a conference about the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, how could you not talk about these verses, right? Y'all did know you were coming to this kind of a Bible conference, right? We're not coming here to speak in tongues, other than Dez's message last night. That was pretty cool, wasn't it? So we all learned some new tongues last night. That was something else, yeah. You know, we got to pay the bowls, right? The what? That was so cool. Anyway, the controversy, you know. So, anyway, we've heard these verses, and so be it, and more. Watch what he says here. Look at this. We're going to, again, look out the future now. Verse 9 says this. I'm going to go to verse 8. Verse 8, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. See, all is important because prior to this, remember Paul said he knew in part. But by the time he writes this, now he has the full revelation of the mystery. We don't have time to get all that, but that's part of the reason we have all wisdom and prudence now. He says, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure. There's that word pleasure again. Remember, for his pleasure all things were created. Well, he's got a will in which he takes pleasure, and that pleasure is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ in the ages to come in the body of Christ. Guess who's a part of that? The person living in your skin. You'll shed that skin one day for a new one, right? That's going to be good. He says at verse 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure which he hath purposed in himself. Now watch this. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times. Once again, times is plural there. We're way out there on the chart now. No, I didn't say that right, did I? We're not even on chart out there now. The dispensation. If the word dispensation is the idea of giving out, dispensing. Okay, so think about that. If it's the dispensation of the fullness of times, the purpose for which time and the times were created, so he's going to dispense out something in the times yet to come. What is it going to be? Look at these verses. Look at what it says. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Why might he want to do that? Why does he want to do that? What have we heard this week, all week? Why does he want to do that? Why does he want to gather together in one all things in Christ, both in heaven and on earth? Why? Because Jesus Christ is the center of the heart of the Godhead. He's the focus of the existence of the Godhead. They live for one another, manifested in the second person of the Godhead. God the Father did not become flesh. God the Holy Spirit did not become flesh. You could not see God the Father except that the Old Testament says he clothed himself with light as with a garment. He would be invisible like the Holy Spirit is invisible. But God the Father clothed, he put on clothing. It's light like a garment. The rainbow, I think, Morris, you were talking about that, right? You know, that's the clothing. It goes around in the rainbow. Listen, the gay lesbian, that stole that from God. And they did that on purpose, by the way. That was not an accident. Understand that? You go back there in the book of Ezekiel, and he sees the glory of God. And he sees it as a rainbow. The person, God, sitting on that throne, the last couple of verses of Ezekiel, chapter number 1, he says, this is the likeness of the glory of God. See that there? So the reason he's going to gather together all in one is because Christ, he is the image of the invisible God. He's the one that the Godhead lives to exalt and give the preeminence to. Look with me, if you would, in this same chapter. Watch this. What does he do in verse 20? In verse 20 he says, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand, where? In the heavenly places. And then he says, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Now, let's do a quick cross-reference. Let's make a comparison here. Hold that verse. Go to Philippians 2. And go to Psalms 138. Philippians 2 and Psalms 138. So you're going to have three passages. You're going to have Psalms 138, you're going to have Ephesians 1, you're going to have Philippians 2. And let's go back and look at the phrase in Ephesians 1:21. Notice where he raised him and exalted him to. Verse 21 says this, far above all principality and power and might and dominion. And what's the next phrase there? What's the next phrase? Who does that include? Who does that include? Yes. Watch this. So take that thought with you. That verse says above every name that's named. Look at Philippians 2. Philippians 2, verse 9, watch this. Wherefore God, that would be God the Father, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him. The highly exalted is detailed in Ephesians 1, 20 and 21. That position of high exaltation above all, right? He says in Philippians chapter number 2, again in verse 9, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. There's the phrase again. Hold that verse, go to Psalms 138. This is almost going to sound like blasphemy, and if it wasn't in the written word of God, it would be blasphemy. It would be idolatry. Look at Psalms 138, verse 2. He says, I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth, for thou hast magnified thy word above what? Above whose name? So, okay, when that verse says above all thy name, who's the thy in that verse? That's God. Does God the Father exalt his word even above his own name? Yes. Who in the Bible is called the word of God? Well, then is it any accident that there back in Ephesians chapter number 1, when he says he exalted him above every name that's named, and when he says in Philippians chapter number 2, he gave him a name, verse 9, he says, wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Which name does that include? Above God himself. Do you see that? He gives to the Lord Jesus Christ the same position that he says he has given to his word. Jesus is called the Word of God. What are words? What are words? Communication, excellent. Expressions, right? Yeah. What are words? What's happening as I'm saying words? Okay, so they're forming in my mind. That is probably not helpful anyway. But they're, because I don't have a lot up here, okay? So This is all, I've just pushed play. Lori writes my notes, and then she records them in there, push play. Anyway, so, you know, the speaker, they've got to, in their mind, come up with words that they're going to say to try to take non-material things, thoughts, from their mind. They got to be communicated from a non-material into a through a material instrument, my throat, my voice, my tongue, the lips, right? They got to come out of this vessel into non-material sound waves. They got to be received by a physical receptor, your ears, into your brain. But then they get translated once again into non-material things. They go into your soul. That is all happening when communication. Listen, Jesus Christ is the Word of God. He's the expression of God. He's the one that God, when God says, if you want to know what I'm like, look at Him. He's who I am. And He exalts the Lord Jesus Christ above His own name. When these passages in Ephesians chapter number 1 say He exalted Christ above the thrones, dominions, the principalities and powers. Look with me, if you would, over to the book of Colossians. Look at Colossians. When the Lord Jesus Christ originally created everything. Listen, the Godhead created everything via the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when He created everything, He created it with structure, with intention, with design, with purpose. Does the Godhead function in disorder and chaos? No. But look around us. What do you find in the world today? Disorder and chaos. If God is light, and He is, and that light is so bright that no man can approach unto it, no man has seen or can see, then how come His light doesn't penetrate the darkness of the night? You follow what I'm saying? I mean, stars evidently can. They say stars are billions of light years away, but the light eventually gets to us. Well, how come the light of God doesn't get to us? His actual light. It's because, listen, there's confusion, there's chaos. Darkness reigns in this present creation. There's been a rebellion in heaven and on earth. You know that. But look at this. Look at Colossians chapter number 3 here. Watch what he says at verse 16. Colossians 3:16 says this, "For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth." And he says, visible and invisible. So which ones would be visible? Those would be the things on the earth. The invisible would be what? The things in heaven. You can't see them right now. That's Colossians 1:16. Did I give you the wrong reference? Okay, what did I say? Sorry about that. But you knew which one I was going to, right? Because you guys are all Bible students here. You're way ahead of me, right? Come on now, shake your head yes. Okay. So I want Colossians 1:16. He says, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth." So you have both realms, right? Visible and invisible. So the ones you can see and you can't see. And then he tells you what they are. He says, whether they be, okay, what are, you got thrones, you have dominions, principalities and powers. What do all those things sound like? Yeah, like authority, rulership, government. How many folks here tonight, either presently or former military? Cool. How many Marines here tonight? You see the pride coming out, don't you, right? Okay. Some for fire, right? Anyway, why do I use the illustration of the military? Why? Because you've got order, structure, right? It's falling apart really quickly in our country because of things going on. But listen, you understand you've got the generals, you've got the colonels, you've got the captains, lieutenants, and the sergeant staff. And you understand order. Why do you have to have those ranks? Why? Yes. Some of y'all work with companies, corporations. So you have a president, you've got a CFO, you've got upper management, middle management, that kind of thing, right? Why? Order. So the chaos doesn't reign. So you get things accomplished. When the Lord Jesus Christ originally created everything, it was all created by design and for a purpose. Watch what it says here. Look at verse 17. It says, "And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church." Who's that? That's you. It says, "He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead." What's the next word there? That. When you see the word that in your Bible, what does it mean? What's it there for? It's to show you purpose, right? In the verse, why is he the head of the body of Christ? Why? In the verse. What's it say there? That in all things he might what? Okay, so if he was never made the head of the body of Christ, then would he have and be the preeminent one in all things? See that? See, according to the prophecy program, was Jesus Christ predicted and will he yet be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords on this earth? Yes. But there's a whole way bigger realm than that, the heavenly places. And in order for him to be the preeminent one in all things, not just the earth, he had to be made the head of the body of Christ. Well, wait a minute then. What does that suggest about the position and the members of the body of Christ? Are they kind of exalted? And I don't mean in their own pride and self-righteousness. I'm saying that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, their plan and purpose called the mystery of Christ, the body of Christ, that all along they intended for the body of Christ to have this high exalted position in the heavenly places. That the body of Christ, that whoever would be the head of the body of Christ would be the preeminent one. And guess who that winds up being? And not winds up by accident either. The Lord Jesus Christ. These verses say, look with me if you would at verse 19. It says, for it pleased the Father that in him should what? Okay, let me try to paint a picture here, a little bit more detail if I can. What's this going to, and I'm, by the way, I'm doing this, I'm not done yet, okay, so hang on. All right. So far, what's this going to look like out there in the future? You've got the church, the body of Christ, said to be a new creature, said to be created, said to be God's handiwork. Keep that phrase in mind. The church, the body of Christ, installed in those heavenly places, in those the thrones, the dominions, the principalities and powers, and every name that's named. And Jesus Christ placed as the head of all that. What for? Just to give us something to do? Just to give him something to do? Why does he do this? What'd you say? To run the heavens and then someone... something about pleasure. Something about pleasure. So listen, you can have a company, a business, and you can hire a bunch of people and the work be miserable. Or you can have a company and you can have an environment with where the employees like coming to work. When you find that place, tell us all about it, would you? Anyway, all right. You know, my sons, both of our sons worked for Trader Joe's. Jonathan and Stephen are two younger boys and so forth. And they said Trader Joe's was a fantastic place to work. I don't work for them. I don't get any money by this commercial and so forth. But listen, they did a survey of all the grocery stores in the United States. The Trader Joe's is a small grocery store. They came up as number one in the entire United States. You want to know what Trader Joe's did? They sent to every single employee a $25 gift card. That cost them some money. They say Trader Joe's is a great place to work. People like to come to work there. Customers like to come to that store and so forth. I'm using it as an illustration. God creates this new creature, and he's going to install the members of this new creature in those heavenly places. And he is doing this because he wants to share with the new creature how much he loves the Son, how impressed he is with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's kind of like the Godhead. They're going to have a contest out there in the future. This is not what's going to happen, but it's kind of like this, okay? It's like one morning God the Father is going to wake up and say, hey, son, wait a minute, it's my turn today. I get to show in the body of Christ how impressed I am with you. And the Lord says, oh, man, you know, okay, I'll let you do it today, but I get tomorrow. And the Holy Spirit says, don't forget about me, I'm here. I know I'm invisible, you can't see me, but I'm still here. So the next day, the Holy Spirit wakes up and says, hey, it's my turn. So it's my turn to show how much I appreciate the Lord Jesus Christ, how wonderful he is. And they're going to do it in the body of Christ and through and by the body of Christ. What was the phrase that I said, let's start with? My joy is the joy of you all. The ages upon the ages. You and I will realize that. God the Father will just be expressing in the new creature the reality of how much joy he gets out of us seeing how much he enjoys Christ. And then he gets excited because he sees the joy that we then see in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. There will be a day when every thought that we have and everything in action that we do will truly be completely to the glory of God. So be it. Maybe soon, maybe not, but maybe soon, right? What's the problem with all this right now, by the way? Any ideas? What's the problem with all this right now, right here? Like, again, we don't live there. We live here in the time, right? What's the problem with all this right now? Go with me quickly, if you would, to Romans chapter number 8. Go to Romans 8 here. What's that? Present evil world is exactly right. Right now, the problem is this is not being manifested to the world. The world thinks you're nuts. And according to their standard, we are, you know. See, we believe a different story about how this all got here and why it's all here. We believe a different future is in store. We believe that because we got it out of a book, about a book that claims to be the Bible, that claims to be the written word of God, that claims to be God speaking to humanity. It has changed our thinking about what reality is. That's why we view things differently. That's why we are very strange to the world. But we do agree with the world in this aspect, that there is confusion and chaos out there. There really is. Look what Romans 8 tells us. 18, he says, for I reckon, did you know Paul was a southerner? Yes. All right. Amen. He's a sailor, he says, yeah. He says, for I reckon that the sufferings of what? This present time. And even if you stop there, can you relate to that part of the verse? Yes. He says, for I reckon. He says, when I add all this up, when I add all the sufferings of this present time up, and I add what this plan and purpose is going to look like out there, it is not even worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. When did God start this plan called glory? Before the world began. He ordained this before the world unto our glory. He's called the Father of glory. The Godhead came up with the plan to glorify Christ, and they said, hey, what should we call this thing? And they said, how about glory? A plan called glory. Jesus Christ is said to be the Lord of what? Glory. The Father is the one who comes up with the plan called glory. Jesus Christ is the one who's going to bring it to pass. He's the Lord of the thing. The Old Testament calls him the King of glory because he's going to bring glory to the earth. He's the Lord of glory because he's going to bring it to both realms. He says this, for the earnest expectation of the creature. That word earnest, those two words, earnest expectation, when you read those words, think of the word hope. Hope in the Bible isn't like, well, maybe my team is going to win the hockey game. They didn't, by the way. The Ducks lost. Congrats to you Chicago fans. You know, so, you know, yeah. Honor to whom honor is due. Wait till next time. Anyway, okay. That's like sore loser, isn't it, you know? Listen, the creation earnestly expects, they earnestly anticipate that what God promised is going to come to pass. That verse says, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for. What's it waiting for? He's waiting for the sons of God to be put on display, for the sons of God to be manifested. Why would the creature be waiting for that? Let's keep reading. He says, for the creature was made subject to vanity. When you make something subject to vanity, dude, what does that mean? Vanity means what? Emptiness. It appears it has no purpose, right? Look around and death keeps winning. Decay, destruction, everything keeps falling apart. So you look at the creation. The creature was made subject to vanity. Not because the creature sinned. The plants, the fish, the deer, the birds, they didn't eat the forbidden fruit. The earth itself didn't sin. But it was made subject to vanity. Not willingly, but by reason. Whoever it was that subjected this creation to vanity did it on purpose. They had a reason. By reason of him who has subjected the same in what? In hope of delivering it one day. When the fall happened, one of the reasons God put the earth under the curse, even though the earth didn't sin, listen, the fall was different than the curse, right? They're not the same event. One of the reasons that God put the earth under the curse is because he says, in a sense, to the adversary, and he says to the earth, he says to the adversary, listen, yeah, you got the earth for now. You got the crown from Adam now. But I refuse to let this earth produce to glorify you in its full capacity. So I'm going to restrain it. And in saying that to the adversary, he says to the creation, but I'm going to get you saved one. I'm going to get you, I'm going to get you released one day. So you just trust me on this, he says to the creation. See that there? He says, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope, because the creature itself also shall be what? Delivered from what? The bondage of corruption. Then what is it under right now, still yet today? It's still under the bondage of corruption. Bondage means it's not able to produce to its full capacity. Corruption means that everything's decaying and falling apart. But it's going to be delivered from that. This whole creation, heaven and earth, is going to be delivered. It's going to be liberated into the unfettered capacity to be able to produce to the glory of Almighty God, to whatever extent the grace of God is able to have it produce. Isn't that amazing? Think about the phrases that God uses that Paul write. He says things like this, according to the riches of his grace. Think about that phrase, the riches of his grace. If grace is given freely, if riches is like a word, we can't relate to that word, can we, by the way? You know, riches is like how wealthy he is. The riches of his grace. However wealthy that God is in his capacity and his willingness just to give and give freely. Think about that verse now in Ephesians 2:7. It says this, that in the ages to come, what's he going to do? He's going to show, he's going to put on display the exceeding, not just the riches, but the exceeding riches of his grace. Each successive age that he's going to roll out, it's almost like each successive age is going to be demarcated by God unfolding some new depth and length and breadth and height of how wealthy and rich he is in his capacity to give freely. Each new age. Yeah. You know, you've heard me say this before, and I know we kind of joke about it a little bit, but it's in a good way. God is just going to wow us with what he thinks of Jesus Christ. He's going to put on display his capacity to glorify Christ and give forth grace. It's going to overwhelm us. We're going to say, Lord, I can't take any more of this great stuff. Please, you're doing too much. And he says, no, I got way more to get. I haven't begun to tap this thing. But he said, Lord, no, we just can't handle it anymore. Instead of being adrenaline junkies, we'll be Jesus junkies. It's amazing to think about that. Just the ages upon the ages upon the ages where God is going to say, my joy is in Christ, but my joy is the joy of you all, where you guys see and experience with me the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. So when that verse says, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption, into what kind of liberty?
Glory.
It's a liberty in which glory has unfettered reign, unbound capacity to show forth its intention. You're going to be there because of the blood of Jesus Christ. By God's grace. For by grace, ye are saved. Through faith. You took me out. God says you decided to take me at my word. You didn't see me. I didn't talk in your ear. You read verses in a book that I claim was my book, and you took it at what it said. Through faith. And it was the gift of God, not of works. And now the next phrase says what? Lest any man should. Is there anything in what we've talked about tonight? Any place for you and I to boast other than he that glorieth, let him glory where? In the Lord, see that there? Next verse says, for we are his what? Workmanship. Next word? Created. You know, back here, Adam, you can't see in the there, Adam was a creation. Adam was one new man. The body of Christ is a new creature. One new man to fill the heavenly places out there. Look with me, if you would, over to Colossians. Ephesians. Go to Ephesians. Think about the word universe. It is interesting that the Bible doesn't actually use that word. It doesn't say God created the universe, but it's a good word, right? Universe, universe. What does the word universe mean? It means one verse, one song. The whole orchestra is going to be playing the same music. And it's going to be the music not that comes from the adversary who fell. The one who was created to be the choir director among the angels. In this case, the music is going to come right from the heart of the Godhead. Singing one story, singing his story, about the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to be a good song. It's going to be good music. It was kind of funny when I was thinking, you know, when all the kids are up here doing their music, this and that. You know, I have the great privilege, and I really genuinely consider it a wonderful privilege to teach the teens all week and so forth. Mike teaches the juniors and so forth, and it really is an honor. And I was thinking, you know, I'd have a fear with bringing the teens up here because of the songs they sing and the dance they do, right? So anyway, that's a joke. Come on now. I don't mean that, but maybe we should do that, have the teens up here one day, right? What do you think? Yeah, he managed to, you know, where did I say to go? What I want to do is I want to go to Ephesians chapter number 2. Watch this. Ephesians 2. Jesus Christ is said to be the Prince of Peace. Right now the world is in chaos and confusion. God is said to be the God of order. He's going to bring order to this confused, divided, corrupt creation. And he's going to bring order under the headship and authority of Jesus Christ. Look at these phrases here. Look at verse 14. In Ephesians 2:14, it says, for he is our what? Look at verse 15, the last part of the verse. So making what? Verse 17, and came and preached what? Why the repeated emphasis to peace? Why? And while you're thinking about that, go to Colossians 1. While you're thinking about that, go to Colossians 1. Why the repeated reference to peace? He makes peace among the Jew and the Gentile. He makes peace between God and man. He makes peace by the blood of the cross, which is what the passage in Colossians says. Why this repeated reference to peace? When you look out there in the creation today, heaven and earth, does it look like there's peace? When you look just on the earth itself, does it look like there's peace? It doesn't at all. Listen, some wonderful changes are coming to this universe. It's going to be a universe where peace does reign. And it's going to be rain. It's going to rain because the Prince of Peace is the one who's going to bring it into effect. How is he going to do that? Well, look at Colossians chapter number 1 here. It says this. Colossians chapter number 1. Look at verse 20. Colossians 1:20 says, "And having made peace," how? Do you see what it took? It took the blood of the Son of God in order to bring about peace. The fact that it took the blood of the Son of God not only tells us something about the depth and the reality of our sin, but it tells us about the depth and the reality of the rebellion itself. It took God sparing not his own Son. It took him delivering him up for us all. There was no other way. To defeat the adversary, to crush the rebellion, to redeem me and you, and to bring to pass that plan called glory, his eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus. Now, I'm going to wind this down. That doesn't mean I'm done yet, but I'm going to wind this down, okay? So far, what are we saying? What's this? What's the future of the mystery of Christ? Glory. The future of the body of Christ. What it's going to look like out there? Is the new creature installed in those thrones, dominions, principalities and powers in heavenly places with glorified bodies likened unto the glorified body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, perfectly conformed to the image of his Son in the presence of the Father in love with the predetermined destiny to the adoption. And then the ages upon the ages, God showing forth in the body of Christ and his word working in members of the body of Christ, showing how much he loves the Son, how much the Son loves the Father. Truly, the body of Christ is going to be a representation, a picture, the trophy of his grace. Where'd he get us from? And not just dust, go deeper. We were children of wrath. We were children of disobedience. Lost and condemned. And God says, out of that, I'm just going to give him a message and see who will believe me. And I will change their eternal destiny forever. One that's exceeding abundantly above all they could ever have asked or thought to do or to come to pass. Eternal glory is going to be amazing. Are you getting that picture? You realize this would be total fantasy, total Hollywood, total dreamland, except that it's written in the Word of God. We're not making this up. No preacher that stood on this pulpit this week made this stuff up. It came right out of the mind of God. Revealed to the Apostle Paul. You understand now why Satan absolutely wants to keep the mystery a mystery? We always need to remember it was through the blood of the cross. I want to close with just a few more verses. To ensure that this program comes to pass exactly like God intended it to come to pass, he hid some things. First of all, what have we been talking about all week that he kept hidden? What was it? The mystery. But he hid something else. Are you in Colossians? Look at Colossians 3. He hid something else. to ensure that it would come to pass successfully. I'm going to start at verse 1. Colossians 3, verse 1 says this: "If ye then be risen with Christ," and have you been? That if there is not the if of doubt, but the if of argument, the if of logic, you have been risen with Christ. He says, "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God." Okay, what are those things? Those things are those thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, and so on, right? He says, set your affection on things above. Why would we want to do that? Because that's where God's affection is set. That's where Christ is set. He set things above. You see how the Word is calling us to find our affection, the place where God finds His affection. He says, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. You're part of the plan to reconcile the heavenly places. You're not part of the kingdom plan on the earth. When people want to make you spiritual Israel, they're totally taking your mind off that which God finds affection in the dispensation of grace. He says this. Watch this. Here it is. It's verse 3. "For ye are dead, and your life is" what? There's that word again. There's that word again. The hidden things of God. I got a question for you. Why did God keep the mystery hidden? Why? Why? Yeah, exactly. Because had Satan known the mystery, it was the information by which he could have thwarted and beat the program. He could have dethroned Jesus Christ, and that's what Lucifer wanted. He says, "I will set my throne above the stars of God. I want that spot." So how successful was God at keeping the mystery a mystery? Why did he keep the mystery a mystery? Because it was too valuable of a plan to let it get out to anyone who did not appreciate and love the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, "I cannot take a chance at this information getting out, because if this information gets out, there's no one that loves the Lord Jesus Christ like we, the Godhead, do. And they will use this plan to their own glory, not for the glory of Christ." So he hides it. That verse says, your life is hid with Christ where? Why hide you? For the same reason. To guarantee its success. Just like it was impossible for the adversary in his wisdom to outsmart God and get the mystery information and hence defeat the plan, it is absolutely impossible for the adversary in all his many attempts to get you out of Christ. You're hidden in God. And how successful is God at keeping what he hides? Are you glad for that? That's a pretty cool verse about security, don't you think? I'm going to close. That's a terrible thing for preachers to say, isn't it? Preachers are always liars. Yea, let God be true and every preacher a liar. Right? But really, let's do this. Get two verses. Get Psalms 19. I know brother talked about this one earlier tonight. We're going to look at it from a little bit of a different perspective. Get Psalms 19. This time go also to 1 Thessalonians 2. Get Psalms 19 and get 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2. Get Psalms 19 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Do you remember we started with the verse where the Apostle Paul is saying about the Corinthians, he says, "But my joy is the joy of you all." But can you now see an extension to that is God saying about the body of Christ in reference to Jesus Christ, that, "Guys, my joy is the joy of you all." He says, "I want you to see Christ, who he is. I want you to find the joy of the Lord Jesus Christ that I find in him." It's no wonder Paul says in Ephesians 3, "that I may know him." I'm not anywhere near what that verse is saying. The depth of what that verse says and means, I'm not even near that. I freely admit that. but we can still press towards the mark, don't we? So look at another verse. That while Paul is saying this about the Thessalonians, by extension, what if he's speaking on behalf of God, which he is, of course. Look at this verse. Look at 1 Thessalonians 2, this time verse 19. 1 Thessalonians 2:19. Paul says to the Thessalonians, he says, "For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming?" Paul says that about the Thessalonians. But is it valid? Is it fair to, by extension, say, you know what? This, can you kind of see God saying that about the body of Christ and how he wants the body of Christ to see in Christ what he finds in Christ? So the Father would say to us, and I'm not suggesting to change your verse. I'm not doing that. You understand that? I'm just saying, man, there just might be something here. That God would be saying to us, for what is our, the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming? He's saying, listen, you, the body of Christ, you are our joy. The Godhead finds joy in the body of Christ. You're the crown of his rejoicing because you trusted Christ. Because you saw in Christ value, merit, worth. God says, I find joy in that because I find joy in Christ, and you're finding that as well. Psalms 19 says this. I realize this is a prophecy. I realize this is in the book of Psalms. It's a wonderful psalm, by the way. But what if we, by extension, maybe suggest something else? I'm not saying the mystery is back here in Psalms. It's not. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying the revelation of the mystery is hinted about back here, known about. That's not what I'm saying, because it's not. It was never made known to anyone in human history until it was first made known to the Apostle Paul. But what if, out there in the ages to come, would it be true to say that the heavens will declare the glory of God by you being there? Will the glory of God be declared in the heavenly places because he's going to put you there? Look at that verse. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his... You know what word that is? That word handiwork? That's the same idea as in Ephesians 2:10, his workmanship. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. Firmament, for you see the word firm in there? It's firm. It's going to last forever. The rebellion's going to be folded up and taken out of the way. But what's going to be last forever is that which is firm and stable and established forever. He says, day unto day uttereth speech, night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. I submit to you that in the ages to come, people on earth and the angels in the heavenly places are just going to be impressed with the Lord Jesus Christ, because they're going to look up into the heavens. Like men in time past could look in the heavens and see the gospel and the stars. I think one of the brothers talked about that earlier, right? Out there in the future, they're going to look at the heavens and they're going to see the brilliance, the shining of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ out there in the body of Christ. And they're going to go, wow. To God truly be the glory. Our gracious God and Father, we're thankful that we can spend a little bit of time here this evening looking beyond the struggles that we face right here, right now, today in our life. And God, it is your word that does take us beyond, that does take us out there into the heavenly places, that does take us into that glory that shall be revealed. And Father, we just ask individually and collectively as a group now that we might see, even if just a little bit at a time, glimpses of that glory And we know that we can and do see it as we believe your word. We thank you for your amazing love. You spared not your own son, but delivered him up for us all. And you say, how shall you not with him also freely give us all things? Truly, to you, to the Godhead, be the glory. In Christ's name, amen.